Thank you. Well, it's great to be here. I'm Anita Woolley. I'm a professor at Carnegie Mellon University. And I want to start off by just giving you a bit of an intuition for how we got interested in what I'm going to tell you about. So I'm going to start off by giving you two examples. And each pair I describe, I want you to think about which team do you think is going to be successful. So the first example consists of two men's ice hockey teams from the Olympics. So the first team is made up of stars from professional leagues from all around the world. Their home country is hosting the Olympics. Prominent politicians in the country have said that the billions of dollars they spent to prepare for the Olympics would all be worthwhile if this team brought home gold. Okay, so that's motivation. Compare this to the second team. This team was actually convened less than a year before the Olympics. Can we go back one? Made up of amateur and collegiate athletes. And nobody really expected much. They just hoped that they wouldn't embarrass the country since they were also hosting the Olympics that year. So most of us would expect that the team on the left would be more successful. But those of you who know hockey know that this is the Russian men's team from the 2014 Olympics, who was eliminated from contention before the medal rounds even began. And this is the 1980 US men's hockey team, who brought home the gold medal despite all it was working against them. All right, so let's think of another example. This one from presidential cabinets. So you might think it's election season, you're electing a person. Well, in fact, you're electing a person and his or her team of advisors. So in this cabinet was made up of what one historian termed the best and the brightest, highly accomplished, Ivy League educated individuals, strong interpersonal relationships, including even some family members of the president, compared to this cabinet, made up of men who lacked some formal education in some cases and were bitter rivals in a hotly contested presidential primary. Most of us, again, would expect that the team on the left would be the more successful, but scholars of American history will know that this is the Kennedy cabinet, which was responsible for some huge decision-making debacles. This is the Lincoln cabinet, who passed historic legislation despite being in a deeply divided country. What these examples really illustrate is that A, we're really bad at predicting which teams are going to perform well in the future, in part because we have a tendency to focus a lot on individual attributes and less on how the group actually works together. So a question that's important to ask is, why were these teams successful? And what my colleagues and I would put forth to you is that one potential answer is collective intelligence. And so some of the research I'm going to tell you about will support this idea and hopefully leave you with about two different ideas for how you can build smarter teams. We have a strong tendency to focus on hiring smart individuals, but we don't know enough about how to build smart teams. And one of the reasons why we focus on individual intelligence is because there's some very good metrics for it. So we're all familiar with G for general intelligence. This is the idea that underlies IQ tests and is highly predictive of how individuals perform in a variety of domains. We started our research wondering if there is an analogous factor, C, for collective intelligence. Are there teams that are consistently good at working together across many different domains, and can we use that information to predict which teams will perform well in the future? So we started our research to explore if collective intelligence even exists. We had teams come to our lab. They spent many hours together performing a whole variety of tasks. We found that teams that did well on one kind of task, like say a creativity task, were also good at mathematical tasks and other sorts of problem-solving tasks. When we calculated a score based on how they performed on all of these tasks, we were able to then predict with a pretty high degree of accuracy how they performed in the future when we brought them back to perform another more complex task. And we were able to do so much better than simply knowing the individual IQs of the team members themselves. So we've replicated this finding a few different times and repeatedly find that collective intelligence is a much better predictor of how teams perform than individual intelligence, whether you look at the average intelligence of team members or even the intelligence of the smartest person in the room. So then we set about trying to figure out, well, if it's not individual IQ that determines collective intelligence, what does? And some of what we found was rather surprising. So one of our first observations was that the proportion of women in the team is related to collective intelligence. And at first we thought it was a linear relationship, but now that we've collected data on several hundred teams, we find that it's more of a curvilinear relationship. So on this graph, this is average collective intelligence, and what you'll notice is that when teams include less than 50-50 females, they tend to oscillate around average. But once you have more than half of the group female is when you see that the teams are consistently above average. However, there's still a benefit to diversity. It's not the case that all female teams are always way above average. So one of the reasons, though, as we dug deeper into this, why we see this relationship is another trait that we measure, which is social perceptiveness. So social perceptiveness is an ability to pick up on subtle nonverbal cues from other people. We give all of the participants in our studies a test called the Reading the Mind and the Eyes test. In this test, they see only the eye region of the face, and they have to draw inferences about what this person is thinking or feeling based on a list of choices. We find that women score higher on this test than men, and that teams that include people with higher scores on tests like these are more collectively intelligent. We also measure a number of attributes of communication in the groups and have particularly noticed that the distribution of communication is important. Specifically, if you have one or two people who dominate the conversation, the team is much less collectively intelligent than if you have more equal distribution of conversation. We've also conducted these studies with teams working together online and collaborating via text chat, and we find very similar results. Equality in communication is still important even when they're using text chats. It's also important even when you look at who's contributing what to their shared products. And similarly, in these online teams, we surprisingly find that social perceptiveness is just as important. So reading the mind in the eyes test is predictive of collective intelligence even when team members are not seeing one another's facial expressions. Research that's just coming out from a team in the Netherlands further shows that collective intelligence is really driven by the lowest scoring member on tests of things like reading the mind and the eyes. In other words, including somebody who has, you know, really poor ability in that domain really seems to drag down a team that otherwise would be high performing. So with that, I want to leave you with two ideas that are, you know, based on the consistent findings of the studies that I've told you about, as well as others that we've conducted. First is that it's really important when you're convening a team to set egalitarian norms. Over and over again, we see that equality of contribution is important. This really comes from convening a team in which there are no stars, as well as no people who are slacking off or loafing. The second piece is you really need to pay attention to the skills, the collaboration abilities of the people in the team, and specifically avoid bringing in people who are going to drag the team down. People who are very negative, who are domineering, can exert a disproportionately negative effect on collective intelligence. You want the people who are really good also, but avoiding the people who will really drag things down is equally important. So hopefully, by paying attention to a few of these attributes, we can not only hire smart people, but also create smart teams. So with that, thank you very much.